Namaste. In the post-COVID scenario, Swadeshi again is the buzzword. There are many multiple thinkings going on how to deal with this new scenario and economic and technological challenges that the world is facing. Every country is trying to find its own solutions. In India, there is one movement which is trying to provide the Indian alternative to this perspective of capitalist globalism on the one hand and socialist globalism on the other hand. That is the Indian Swadeshi movement. And today with us we have Sri R. Sundaram ji, renowned chartered accountant and national convener of Swadeshi Jagran Manch, to discuss all issues related to Swadeshi movement, challenges and the opportunities for India. Namaste.
Namaste, Kegarji. Namaste to your team.
First of all, how do you see the Swadeshi movement and the relevance of Swadeshi thought in the post-COVID scenario?
Before that, I will take 1 minute. what I feel as the achievements of Swadeshi Jagran Manch in the last 30 years of its existence. We have been saying that every country has its unique model of development, and this one size fits all theory is outdated. Today it has been conclusively proved that every country has its own model of development. That is what our founder has called, that it's a third way. Third way is not something, he has again not defined what third way is. He says there is one guy, there is capitalism, or there is one communism, but every country has its own model of development, that is the third way. So we have now the entire, if you see any document of the World Bank or IMF, they acknowledge this fact that every country has its own model of development. Second thing, we have been saying that the top-down approach, the rising tide lifts all the boat, that also is not yet validated. So the bottom-up approach is still valid. And third biggest achievement as far as India is concerned, we have placed before in the domain of the nation the contribution of ordinary Indians in the economic development which was not done earlier. For example, the contribution of small-scale industry, their share in everything, the export or employment, everything is more than 50%. In terms of employment, it is even larger. The contribution made by our unskilled people working throughout the country. So their remittance of valuable foreign exchange is $75 to $80 billion per annum, whereas the corporates are net spenders. So when we place this data in the public domain, the confidence of the nation has gone up. It gives us a new thinking, and people are sort of looking at these people with respect. So this is as far as our existence has contributed all these things. Today I see 4 or 5 developments globally. There is going to be a paradigm shift in the thinking of the West. They are going to abandon what they have been preaching to the rest of the world in the last 4+ decades. Domestic production and domestic employment are going to be the mantra, at least for the next 2-3 decades. This violent globalization that has been practiced and orchestrated by the so-called developed countries will pave way for more orderly globalization. That is what our founder has also visualized. Natural farming will replace chemical-based industrial farming. The West has become allergic to fertilizers or pesticides, something, especially after this COVID. This, I think, the traditional Indian agricultural model has a lot to contribute to the world. So these are all the this, and then environment will start playing an important part in every project, because people have seen clean Ganga, please have they've experienced pure air in Delhi, you know. Then environment, but what they have realized what is the cost to the environment because of this, you know, unchecked growth. And the present day world institution, this is IMF or World Bank, which they have outlived their utility. WTO is in coma. This we have been taking from 2001 onwards. The durability of WTO is for one of decades now, which has been conclusively proved. So focus on every country's development, more orderly globalization, respect for nature, all these things will happen. This is because in the changed context of COVID.
You spoke about the importance that entire Swadeshi movement has been talking about, the role of small industries and informal sector in the economy. But what we are seeing, you know, one reverse trend, that during the COVID, the highest number of industries that are closed are small and medium. And there is, day by day, there is a formalization of informal sector. So on the one hand, where the banking, which was at the 2008-9 crisis, about which we were talking that this is our strength, now we are, you know, turning them into our, you know, forcefully bringing them into the formal sector, merging banks. So how do you see these two contradictions going?
The smallest people are more vulnerable to these types of great globe-shaking events. It's not for it has not happened for in 1 or 2 days, right? It has been built over a period of time. For example, our study shows that the Indian small scale sector has been consistently facing unethical competition from Chinese for last 5-6 years, you know. So they themselves are already, they were struggling, and this is an onslaught. Yes, the many of them have closed at the moment, but as I told you, they are the largest employment generating sectors. You know, this is every small scale industry is a school for a graduation school for a big industry. So they need a helping hand at this point of time. This is number one. And as far as the banks are concerned, you know, privatization of banks for merger, we want community banks focused on one segment of trade or one segment of the geography of the country, you know. So they will understand this business better. They can lend easily, or they can also recover easily, you know. So this, according to our view, this privatization or this consolidation is not the solution, because every year internationally we see private banks failing internationally, and then even in India Yes Bank has failed. Previously, Global Trust Bank has failed. So the simple solution is not consolidation or privatization. The problem is much more. So COVID has given us an opportunity to take a comprehensive view of what is the need of a small man and how the banking system should function and what is the real solution. So we have been engaged in a serious discussion, and we will be coming out with a report shortly.
Could you elaborate on that, how banking, you just said about banking, how it will what do you envisage?
We envisage more local banks, you know, which can understand the needs of particular business. For example, if you go to Coimbatore, there are thousands and thousands, millions of small scale industries, you know. A banker who can understand the needs of those people, or you come to Karnataka, where Coorg estates are, those who can understand economic, agriculture and coffee economics. So we want the more localized, specialized
institutions.
Financial institutions, which can cater to the credit needs of different types of borrowers, rather than this large bank. Large bank, they have a role to play, like State Bank of India, or let them play their role. But more, we feel that this need is more than that of the large bank.
While we are seeing, you know, there is a new opportunity to think about the alternative models of development. I'm not talking about one model, but alternative models of development.
Mm.
But at the same time, we are seeing the technological integration globally.
Mm.
We are seeing data playing a new role. It is called as the new oil. And artificial intelligence based technology is guiding the entire life of humanity in the future. So, in this kind of techno-globalism, how do you see Swadeshi thought will play a role?
We have been saying for the last 10 years one concept of techno-nationalism, development of indigenous technology. Let it be 5G or let it be technologies like Facebook or WhatsApp, etc. We have been seeing
social
media platforms. No. So our R&D expenses should improve manifold, and we should go in for indigenous technological development, which should be at par with the international standard. I think we have a feeling that India has enough human resources to develop this type of technology. Only a lead has to be given to them. Even elsewhere, even if you go to America or Sundar Pichai, the Indians are leading the technological revolution everywhere. And we feel that if given an opportunity, definitely India can lead this. And as rightly pointed out by you, this is a big challenge we are facing now. Combining the Swadeshi thought with the technological explosion that is taking place. You know? So I should not allow people to think that I am taking them backward or I am against technology. We are not against technology.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, my attempt will be to make use of the technology for the maximum benefit of the people.
Besides technology and artificial intelligence, what are the challenges you foresee? Because I see intellectually still Swadeshi thought is not very fashionable.
You are right. One area where we feel that we have a lot to do is we have to present workable models before the nation. What I mean by Swadeshi. Swadeshi way of life. Swadeshi view of business. Swadeshi as a thought. And even Swadeshi as a Swadeshi way of a globalization. That also I have to define. No? Because I have to show that I am not against globalization. So these things now we want to come out with workable models.
Mm-hmm.
And if you visit the different parts of the country, if you go to Anand in Gujarat, where you see people employed from 6 to 12 p.m., 6 a.m. to 12 p.m., everybody is employed. Even women folk is doing some economic activity in their residences.
Mm-hmm.
And we are told that the credit deposit ratio in Anand is hardly 20%. There are no takers for credit.
Mm-hmm.
So this is Swadeshi model.
Mm-hmm.
So these types of models are prevalent not only in Anand and Gujarat,
mm-hmm.
but at least in hundreds of other parts of the country. You know, this we want to research, document, and place it before the nation. That is, we have already have a functioning economy,
mm-hmm.
with a little bit of technological and intellectual support. You know, this can become manifold. So the challenge I feel is that more documentation. And I have to present more workable model before the nation, and I have to reach out to the intelligentsia to say that what I am saying is not against anything but for something.
What Swadeshi Jagran Manch is doing for this? Because I feel government is also trying to come with some cluster model related to this.
Correct.
There are already for example, in UP, Moradabad is known for
brass items. Tirupur is known for hosiery items.
So it is a functional Swadeshi model, actually.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, in our academics, in our intellectual discussions, they are not presented or discussed as functional Swadeshi models.
Mm-hmm.
Who are very much ready to cope up with the trends of globalization. They are more export oriented. But still, they are running with the pure Swadeshi ethos. So, is there any initiative from Swadeshi
Jagran
to?
Yes, there is an initiative. Now we have identified around 400-500 clusters across the country. No?
Mm-hmm.
We are also shortly setting up our own research center. And we are trying to align with the management institutes and different universities to make this success story as part of curriculum. So if I say somebody about London and then I present it to the students, they may not be able to visualize correctly. Suppose, for example, Sridhar Membu is there. I think Arnesh would have written about him. He has gone and settled down in his native place. And he has shared with us one information that a 14-year-old girl who has not seen computer 3 months before, now she is a computer programmer. He says these types of talents are available in rural India. The only thing is we have to go reach out to them and give an opportunity. So our attempt is manifold to document the existing successful models, to make this a part of academic curriculum, and then reaching out to the rural areas and then see whether how we can harness the talents that is already available. Providing employment to people or making them do business as they are and where they are. Yeah, this is another fallout of this goal. This COVID is now people have started looking at rural areas very seriously. I have come across one interesting model in Nasik, where a girl, she prefers to get married to an educated farmer there rather than getting married to a software engineer working in Mumbai. The reason given out by her is this man goes out by 7 a.m. in the morning and comes back by 2 a.m. the next day, making life miserable for both of them. Then they live in a 100 square feet apartment. So here they have seen what the real pleasantness of life. So technology is helping you to move from urban areas to rural areas. Now we have seen the last 1 month for people working from rural areas but still continuing with their activity. So I see a shift. This is the right time to remove this urban congestion and harness rural talent. So these are all the things that the society would like to take forward.
But till now, unfortunately, our model has been seeing urbanization as one of the most important indicator of development.
Providing urban facilities in rural areas and urbanization are two different concepts. We have to provide facilities to the people. It doesn't matter whether you give it in Mumbai or doesn't matter you give it in Tenkasi. But facilities should be given to them. So the urbanization will undergo a definitional change. It will not be urbanization, but taking the development to the a sort of even development across the country to the extent possible.
Now, you are right that WTO is facing its own challenges. IMF is facing the credibility crisis. But at the same time, ultimately, when you are talking about whether techno-nationalism or nationalist models of development, one model we are seeing is China model. It is, in a way, state-controlled capitalism, but purely rooted in nationalist thinking. That is possible because it is a closed economy. But it is consistently posing a threat to democracies like India.
Correct.
Either through dumping or through, interfering in technological advancement or data controlling. The similar approach is there from the Western world. So in this, sandwich situation, how do you see
another positive fallout of this COVID? People have understood the Chinese way of doing business, unethical business. If you allow me to say, there are two characters in India. One is Rama and another is Krishna. For the first man, means are as important as the end. He will not deviate from the path of Dharma. For second man, he is a manipulator. For him, annihilation of adharma, you can adopt any means. So when we deal with your international customers, you be a Krishna and don't be a Rama. So today the world, we are getting inputs from across the world that everybody wants to move away from China. And enough business space is being vacated for India. Now the international economy is not functioning on the basis of comparative cost theory. If Iraq starts building its petrol in Europe,
mm-hmm.
it is subject to attack from US.
Mm-hmm.
There is an interesting episode, the former M.R. Sivaraman, former nuclear scientist, shared with me when we traveled together in India. He was supposed to attend a conference in the United States. The United States decided that somehow he should be prevented from attending that conference. They said that there is a full stop between M and R. So this name is different from that M.R. Sivaraman's name. His visa was denied for three days. And fourth day they apologized, no, sir, we have found your visa papers correct, sir. We sincerely acknowledge apologies for the trouble created. But this day conference was over. So this is the way in which the international commerce is being carried on. And if you are going to talk about values and theories in this atmosphere,
mm-hmm. yeah.
I think we will be the losers.
So, but in the world global trade scenario,
mm-hmm.
it is they say that, you know, it is the way the Europe thinks, the world thinks. In that context, mm-hmm. where is our Swadeshi? Where is the place for our Swadeshi? Because the whole world, mm-hmm. it is what the West is, their theories and their practices are being practiced. So where is the place?
So today, 140 crore market is my strength. Everybody is knocking at my doors. So my message to our local people, when foreigners can see a tremendous business opportunity and they are coming to India, there is enough opportunity for you to indigenously grow. India can produce almost any products you want, except maybe items like petrol, oil, or over which we don't have control. To put it in language, now there is bhajan, there is Bhagavad Gita, there is Upanishad. In bhajan, I define as mass production item. That we are doing it very well. The next stage is a little bit of research-based activity. He was talking about technology. You are the user of mobile phones, but you are not the inventor of mobile phones. You are the user of aircraft, but you are not the producer of aircrafts. So from bhajan you have to evolve to Gita, and from Gita you have to evolve to Upanishad. Upanishad, I say that India should become the producer of the most technologically advanced products in the world, for which I should create an enabling environment. The scientific talent of India, it has already been conclusively proved that they are capable of doing anything. Only thing, the connecting dot is missing. Today I really feel that there is a job much has a lot of work to do. I have to improve my work at least 10 times to take my message and then to give some direction to the whole economic thinking of the time.
So do you see Make in India a step forward in that direction, or you want to go for Made in India?
I prefer Made in India.
Mm-hmm.
First you were made in India,
mm-hmm.
then make in India,
mm-hmm.
then made for India, now finally made by India.
Mm-hmm.
So made by and for India will be my preference, because being a Swadeshi man.
Mm-hmm.
But I am not closed.
Mm-hmm.
I want to collaborate with different countries who share our ideas. Because now we have also, in the last 30 years of existence of our Swadeshi Jagran as a movement, we realize the importance of collaborating with our similar thinking nations.
So what are the sectors you see opportunities in coming days for Indian youth and in Indian market where Swadeshi experiments can be carried forward?
I'll rate technology as a first area. Indian technology,
mm-hmm.
Even 5G.
Mm-hmm.
We are in discussion with the IIT director at Chennai.
Mm-hmm.
Say that India can be a global leader in 5G technology.
Mm-hmm.
India can be a global leader in computer-based education.
Mm-hmm.
India can also catch up and exceed China in artificial intelligence, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So technology plus our tradition.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to be left out from anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Do you think of this Atmanirbhar campaign,
mm-hmm.
will it in a way affect that? You said that you need infusion from technological infusion, cooperation, and infusion from other places.
Well, wherever possible, wherever necessary.
Okay.
This Atmanirbhar Bharat has in fact helped me
mm-hmm.
in taking forward my Swadeshi thoughts in a dramatic way. The very articulation of this Atmanirbhar concept, I see that it's an articulation of the Swadeshi ideas in a different form. Be vocal. All these things, these are all Swadeshi ideas.
There are more critics of Swadeshi thought. They say that, you know, it is not workable because it is based on Indian ethos, dharma shastras and other things. That was the basic concept. In this, again I am coming to the same question, that in this global scenario where we are following the Western model, even when we say Atmanirbhar also, we are following the same model.
I am not subscribing to you that we are following the Western model. In the initial stages, I have told you that we are for indigenous development model, not only for India but different countries. So we are doing business in our own way. I think we are not copying it from in every type of business. We are not copying it from the outside world. Wherever it is necessary, we collaborate. Wherever it is not necessary, I find my way own out. For example, here I am also interacting with business people. Say why every international agreement results in a deficit for India? For India has surplus only with Bangladesh and United States. For every other international agreement, I am running a deficit. Why this is happening? If it is happening because of the incompetence of the business people, then they have to rectify. If it is happening because of the government policies, or the government has to change their policies, ultimately, you know, I want my share. I don't want anybody's share because I want my share to be protected. But today my biggest challenge is providing employment to the 90 crore, not only employment, but my employment and business and livelihood opportunities to 90 crore plus people. if it clashes with that, my first priority will be to do that.
Now, there are various stakeholders in this process if we really want to take it forward. So at the one hand, there is a government, then there are business people who themselves are actually carrying forward certain ideas on Swadeshi model. Then there are academicians, technocrats, and of course common people. Now if we take just two ends, government and common people, as a national convener of Swadeshi Jagran, what would be your message? How, in this post-COVID scenario, how should government, you know, take this as an opportunity to really realize the ideas of Atmanirbhar Bharat, and how people should?
The government has floated a very interesting idea. Now my responsibility is to work with the government and see in what form it can be really implemented in this country. This will be my first prayer, because I congratulate the government for they have done this. Now my responsibility is to define what Atmanirbhar Bharat is in the interest of the country. Now, in this process, various thoughts will evolve. So the government, I want to work with the government and set a direction to realize the dreams of Swadeshi Jagran Manch also, because they are articulating my ideas at the moment.
And from the common public, what do you
As far as the Swadeshi as a concept, I think we have largely succeeded in taking the message of Swadeshi across the country. Where I have to do more work is to do work with the business people and the intelligentsia, the academia of the country, which is a job that is to be done with more force.
So any initiatives to do that?
Yes, we will be launching a first thing we are coming out with research documents. We will be coming out with a series of publications, and we will all, our cadre will also fan across the country, making use of this this 2-3 years. It has given me an opportunity to give a new direction to the economic development of the country. So my karyakartas in different states will go out, and then they will try to take this model. Even in India also, we see that different states have different models of them. For example, if you go to Kerala, India is a demographically young country, but Tamil Nadu and Kerala are aged. So if I go and try to develop a manufacturing unit in Tamil Nadu or Kerala, then I have to again depend on laborers from Uttar Pradesh or Bihar. So my advice to the government of Tamil Nadu and Kerala is, please go in for more service-oriented invest more in technology. For example, Kerala, a lot of non-resident Indians, non-Keralas mm-hmm. have come back to Kerala with, not only with money,
skills,
with some expertise also. Mm-hmm. So you make use of them and then take your development of your state in a different country. Uttarakhand is a Himachal Pradesh, they are all tourism oriented states. Mm-hmm. Jharkhand and Orissa are mining states. Maharashtra and Gujarat are manufacturing. Every state has its own dimensions. So I prefer Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and Rajasthan to develop manufacturing industries in a big way. And the rest of the states to focus on the strengths they have. And finally we can arrive at a mutually complementing model of development. We see every state economy needs a slightly different approach plus a national approach.
Thank you Sundaramji for sparing your time and sharing your thoughts about the Swadeshi movement, relevance of it in the post-COVID world, the challenges and of course the opportunities you see for yes. India and the Swadeshi movement in the coming future.
Today I am a very confident man that we are determined to see that our concept is accepted and taken forward. So I thank organizer for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts. Our interaction should continue.
Thank you.